And as soon as I got to the Welcome to Lewiston sign, I'm not a big crier, but I just started weeping.
Amen.
And I want you to know, Pastor David, that God is going to bless this ministry, your ministry.
Amen.
And I felt the words while you were up here speaking, that this is a year of accelerated increase in rapid growth.
Yes.
And the reason why that is, it's not because of clever ideas or man's wisdom, but it's because you simply said, Lord, I'll host your presence.
Glory.
And that's what has taken place here today. Yes. And I don't know about you, but I'm just excited for Growing Together Ministries. I'm excited for
Glory.
What God is doing in Lewiston, North Carolina. Can you shout amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
The Bible says, with joy we draw water from the wells of salvation.
Yes.
See, salvation is not just fire insurance. It won't just keep us from going to hell, but salvation is peace for our mind, it's healing for our body.
Amen.
And how do we obtain it? The Bible says, with joy we draw water out of the well of salvation. It's something about having the freedom and liberty to come into the house of God each and every Sunday, and with joy we can just praise the Lord.
Yeah.
How many of you are thankful that we can come in freedom and worship the Lord? The Bible says in Nehemiah 8:10, the joy of the Lord is our strength.
Yes.
And His presence is fullness of joy.
Yeah.
And at His right hand are pleasures forevermore, not pressures, but pleasures forevermore.
Amen.
How many of you are thankful for God in His presence?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Well, those of you that you've already heard my beautiful wife, my anointed wife, sing this morning. This is Lauren Turner. Could y'all just give her a little hand? And my baby girl, Claire. This is my youngest daughter, Claire Turner. She's 7 months old. I have an older daughter. She's 3, going on 13. So praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. But God is so good. Amen. If you have your Bibles, I just want to speak with you briefly. And if you want to turn to Psalm 84, verse 11. Psalm chapter 84, verse 11. And if there was a title for my message today, it would be The Master Key to a Life of God's Never-Ending Favor.
Amen.
Or you could also say The Master Key to a Life of Continuous Victory. Hallelujah. When you get there in your Bible, can you shout amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Verse 11 says, for the Lord God is our sun and our shield. He gives us honor and favor. No good thing will God withhold from those who walk uprightly. Let's pray. Father, in these next few moments, I thank you, Lord, for your presence. I thank you for your anointing that is here today, Father. There's no doubt in my mind that you are here, God. You are moving, God. So we thank you, Lord, right now for your word, God, that does not return back to you void, but it achieves and accomplishes the purpose for which you sent it to do.
Yes.
And I ask, God, that you would use your servant today, God, to be your mouthpiece, God. Help me to proclaim your word with great truth, power, and authority, and in love, God. Help your people, God, that their minds will be alert and their hearts will be receptive, God, to receive everything that you have for them. In the precious and mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
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 I don't know about you, but have you ever seen, maybe you've been to a bank or at a school and you've seen a security officer at a bank or a custodian or a janitor, they have this big old loop of keys hanging from the belt. Anybody seen that?
Yeah.
And they have a bunch of keys. Some keys get them into different doors. Some keys, I work at a college, I'm a security officer myself, a deputy sheriff. And I have a big key ring. And on that key ring, I should have brought it today as an illustration, but on that key ring, some keys will get me into the maintenance shop. Some keys will get me into the library and so forth. But the key to the maintenance shop can't get me into the business office where the vault is. The library key can't get me into the president's office.
Come on.
But there's one particular key, and every security officer or every custodian usually has that key. It's called the master key.
Come on,
and
amen.
That key will get you into every door. See, not everybody has access to the master key.
Uh-oh.
Only people who have stood the test and done what was needed to do have that key. Can you say amen?
Glory.
Hallelujah. See, keys are small things that give us access to large things. Though keys are small, they have power and authority to open mighty doors.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. See, you can have a house filled with the finest food, but if you don't have a key, you won't ever be able to access that refrigerator, that stove, that snack cabinet, that freezer that has all that food, and you'll stand right outside that door and starve to death if you don't have a key.
Amen.
You could have the nicest of a vehicle, but if you don't have a key to access it, you'll stand outside that car that was designed and engineered to go fast for the pleasure of driving, and you'll go nowhere. See, you can have a safe full of money, but if you don't have the key or the combination to that safe, then you'll never even be able to purchase a cup of coffee.
Come on.
Even though you've got a wealth of inheritance sitting right inside that safe. See, there's a master key in the Bible that'll give you access to everything that God has for you. All the goodness of God, all the favor of God, all the blessing, all the healing of God that He offers in His precious covenant can be accessed through this one single master key. But before I talk about the master key, I want to talk to you about two other important keys. Now don't misunderstand me. I don't want to demean or defame these two other keys, because these two other keys that I want to talk to you about are very vitally important. They are an absolute necessity for every Christian to have in their life, but they can be limited, and I'll explain. The first key I want to talk to you about is prayer. See, prayer is a powerful tool. Prayer is a powerful key. I believe we need more prayer in the body of Christ.
Yes.
Can you say amen? I look at Pastor David and I see his ministry and how God has accelerated him and Pastor Lisa simply because you have a man of prayer.
Right. Come on.
Hallelujah. Prayer is important, but it can be limited. Not prayer itself can be limited, but based on us it can be limited. You may be saying, well, Travis, how so? Well, one thing, the first way that prayer can be limited is because of sin. The Bible says in Psalm 66:18 that if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord cannot hear my prayer. One translation says that if I had not confessed a sin in my heart, the Lord would not even have heard.
Come on, amen.
Now, don't get me wrong now. The Bible does say in Psalm 28:6 that He will always hear a cry for mercy from a sinner. But what that scripture means in Psalm 66:18 when it says that if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me, that means that if we're continually and constantly living a life of unrepented sin, and then we turn around and try to ask God to bless us, it don't work that way.
Come on, amen. Amen. Preach it, brother. Preach it.
Yes, amen.
Another way, see, prayer can be limited. See, our sin can handcuff God from moving in our life. Another way that our prayers can be hindered, for one, 1 Peter 3:7, the Bible says, honor your wife with love and understanding, so that your prayers will not be hindered. I don't know about you husbands, but I'm going to honor my wife because I need my prayers answered.
Amen.
Another way that our prayers can be limited is through doubt or unbelief. The Bible says in Mark 11:22-24, truly I tell you, have faith in God, for you can say to this mountain, be thou removed and lifted up and cast into the sea.
Yes.
But verse 23 says, but you must really believe that it will happen and do not doubt in your heart.
Amen.
Come on.
See, prayer can be answered, but it can be limited by us because of our doubt and unbelief. The Bible says in James 1:6 that when you ask, do not doubt. For a doubting person is like a wave tossed to and fro throughout the sea.
Right.
A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Let not that man expect to receive anything from the Lord. See, if you're getting on your knees and you're praying and asking God to do something, but then getting right back up off of your knees and saying, well, I know I prayed that, but the Lord, He's never done that for me. Or well, I've never seen a miracle. Or, well, the Lord, He can't heal me. He did that for sister such and such. Or He did that for brother so and so, but I don't think He'll ever do it for me. If your words are portraying the very prayers that you just prayed, God won't receive it. See, what you don't respect, you'll never receive. Can you say
come on. Amen. Amen.
See, our unbelief can handcuff God from moving in our life. Hallelujah. Another key that I want to talk to you about, which many would think is the master key, but it's not, because it can also be limited. That key is faith. Now, although faith is powerful, although faith is incredible, it's a biblical key, but it's not the master key. Because faith can be limited. Not faith itself can be limited, but based on us, it can.
Yes.
It can have limitations.
Amen.
Now, don't get me wrong. Faith is very important. The Bible even says in Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it is impossible to please God.
Amen.
Jesus himself said in Mark 9:23 that all things are possible to him who believes. Faith is powerful. Faith will move mountains, but it can also be limited. How can it be limited, you might ask, Travis? Well, the Bible says in Galatians 5:6, only faith activated, energized, and expressed, and working through love counts for anything. See, faith without love, it doesn't work. I know so many people who are powerful people. They walk in the gift of faith, but they don't have love. Can I tell you that only faith in partnership with love will count for anything? The Bible actually says that in 1 Corinthians 13:2, that if I had the gift of prophecy and understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, but I did not love others, I would be nothing.
That's right.
Come on.
So although faith is incredible, although it's supernatural, although it's biblical and a powerful key, it's not the master key. See, our lack of love and our misuse of faith can handcuff God from moving in our life. But I want to go back to Psalm 84:11. Are you still there?
Yes, amen.
I want to talk to you about 11 powerful words that can change your life. 11 powerful words that are life-changing. The end of that verse 11 says, no good thing will God withhold from them who walk uprightly.
Come on.
I'll say it again. No good thing. The Bible says every good gift and every perfect gift comes from above, from the Father, who there is no changing or shadow of turning. The Bible says, though you fathers are evil, I know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more will your heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask?
Amen.
The Bible says, no good thing will God withhold from those who walk uprightly. That word uprightly refers to righteousness. That word righteousness refers to holiness. So we could also switch that verse and it would mean the same thing. We could also say, no good thing will God withhold from those who live holy.
Amen.
The master key to a life of God's never-ending favor is holiness. Now, I know that I'm about to sound like an 80-year-old preacher from the 1990s, but I want to tell you today that holiness still matters.
Come on. Amen.
To every door that God has for you.
Yes.
Holiness, the Bible says, and I want to talk to you about three things that holiness will do for you just by living a holy life. Three things that will happen automatically. You won't even have to strive for it. You won't even have to ask for it. Just by simply living holy, living a pure life, living a clean life, there's three promises in the Bible that God says you can have access to because you'll have the master key.
Come on, amen.
Hallelujah. But before I talk about that, you may be saying, well, Travis, man, how is that possible? I don't know about you, but I'm a younger guy, and I grew up in a generation where they had this hyper-grace movement, where they felt like, I don't know about you, but I've heard so many people say, well, how many of you know we're all just filthy sinners saved by grace? No. You were a filthy sinner saved by grace, but the Bible says that in 2 Corinthians 5:17, that if any man be in Christ,
that's right,
he is a new creation.
That's right.
The old is old. But hold on. You're a new creature. The Bible says in Galatians 2:20 that it's no longer I who lives, but Christ who lives in me. The Bible says in Romans 6:14 that sin shall no longer have dominion over you, for you are no longer under the law, but you are now under grace. So many people think, and I'm going to give you something, and if you want to tweet something, this is a tweetable moment. Grace is not a license to continue on sinning. Grace is empowerment to overcome sin.
Grace.
You said, well, Travis, man, how is it that I can live free from sin? Can I really live a sinless life? I want to tell you that Jesus said you could. You said, well, what do you mean, Travis? Well, in John 8:11, there was a woman who was caught in the act of adultery. And her accusers, all those religious people, all those Pharisees and Sadducees, they had stones and they were getting ready to stone her. And Jesus looks at them and he says, okay, well, whoever is without sin, you can cast the first stone.
That's right.
All of those people slowly drop the stones on the ground and they walked away.
Come on.
Jesus looked at the woman who was caught in the act of adultery and he said, woman, where are your accusers? She said, sir, there are none.
Come on.
And he said, neither do I condemn you.
Come
now
on,
go
amen.
And sin no more.
Yeah, amen.
The fact that he told her to go and sin no more means that it's possible.
That's right.
Another illustration of that is in John 5:14, the lame man who was lame for 38 years by the pool of Bethesda. When Jesus reached down and healed the man and picked him up, he told him, this is what he said. He said, now stop sinning, lest a thing that's even worse come upon you. He told the man to stop sinning, so that means it is possible. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory to God.
We can live a holy life. The Bible says in Romans 8:1, and I think I've already mentioned it, there is now therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus.
Preach,
see, a lot
preach.
Of modern preachers, a lot of young guys like me, they end that verse right there. This is what they say. How many of you know there's no longer no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus? And they end it. That's not the end of that verse. The Bible says that there is now therefore no condemnation for them who are in Christ Jesus, for those who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit.
Amen.
We can
Amen.
Live by the Spirit. We can walk by the Spirit. The Bible says, walk by the Spirit so that you will not gratify the desires of your flesh. Matthew 6:22 says that the eye is the lamp of the body. If the eye is healthy, the whole body is full of light.
Preach.
But if the eye is unhealthy, the whole body is full of darkness. And if the whole body is full of darkness, oh, how great is that darkness, the Bible says.
Amen.
King David said, I will refuse to look at anything vile or vulgar. One translation, the King James says, he says, I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Joshua 1:8. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so you will be sure to obey everything written in it.
Yes.
Only then will you prosper and be successful
Amen.
In everything you do. Amen. I've heard people say, well, how many of you know, brother, that God never called us to be successful. He only called us to be faithful. No, he actually called us to be both.
That's right.
Daniel had a spirit of excellence about him. Joseph was so in tune with his relationship with God. He lived such a holy life that when Potiphar's wife came to him and tried to say, come on, come sleep
come on.
With me.
Preach.
He did not think about it. Today, what would people do?
That's
today,
right.
people, Jacob didn't say, oh, well, Potiphar's wife, look, you know, I would like to, but I don't want to get caught
That's
by
right.
Potiphar. You know, what if we get caught? No, no, no. Joseph said, how could I do such a wicked thing to my God? See, he was in tune with his relationship. See, today I'm not offering to you legalism. I'm just being real. See, legalism would say, well, you've had this happen in your life, or you've been addicted to this, or you've had this affair, or you've had this bondage, or you've had this addiction, or you've had this divorce, so God can't use you. No, 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 that's not what I'm saying. The Bible says in John 1:19, that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive
Amen.
Us of our sins
Amen.
And cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Today I'm not offering to you legalism, but today what I'm offering to you is a more intimate relationship with your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Glory.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now don't misunderstand me. Perfection
Thank you.
Is a pursuit. It's not a destination. We'll never truly obtain perfection. But it's just always striving for. Jesus himself said in Matthew 5:48, be ye perfect as your Father is perfect. Be ye holy as I am holy.
Preach, brother.
It can be possible. It can be done. Three things that holiness can bring just by simply living holy. The first thing that holiness can bring is divine protection. You say, well, Travis, how so? 1 John 5:18 says, for those who become God's children, stop sinning. For God's Son Jesus holds them securely, and the evil one cannot touch them.
Come on.
Amen. Come on.
Cannot touch them.
Yes.
I'm going to say that again because that's a powerful
Amen.
Verse.
That's right.
The Bible says that for those who become God's children, stop sinning.
Come on.
And because of that, it says, for God's Son Jesus holds them securely, and the devil cannot touch them. How many of you know that when see the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:57 that thanks be unto God
That's right.
who gives us the victory through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Can I tell you today that you're not trying to get the victory in this church today? At 601 Main Street, Lewiston, you've already got the victory.
Come on.
Just
Receive it.
Yes.
Receive it.
Divine protection.
Yes.
Number two, just by simply living a holy life, the Bible promises divine healing and help.
Amen.
You say, well, how so, Travis? Proverbs 3:7 says, fear the Lord and turn away from evil, and then you will have healing for your body and strength for your bones.
Amen.
Just by living holy,
yes.
Whoo,
yes.
Brings help and healing.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but that's powerful to me.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Number three, and the final point, just by simply living a holy life, the Bible promises you divine wealth. Mm-hmm. You say, well, how so, Travis? The Bible says in 1 Timothy 4:8, godliness is profitable unto all things,
yes,
promising benefits in the life that now is, mm-hmm, and in the life to come, eternal life. See, a lot of people think that I'm just supposed to serve God and toil and work and do this and do that and do this list of rules and do that just so I can have rewards in heaven. No, I'm here to tell you today that if you live a holy life, that if you live pure and clean unto,
yes,
Jesus Christ, the, yes, Bible says that godliness is profitable unto all things.
Preach.
Promising,
preach,
benefits in the life that, yes, now is,
yes,
and in the life to come. But see, when we're not living that holy life, when we're out there living in the world, can I tell you today, I've had so many people come up to me, and they say, well, Travis, how could I love a God who allows this to happen to me and allow that to happen to me? But can I give you a picture and an illustration of what God wants to do for you? When we make those statements like that, when we say, you know, God, you're doing this to me, you're doing that to me, I could never serve a God like you because you do this to me. You've never worked this out for me. Can I tell you what that picture is? That would be the same as if somebody was standing out in the ocean and there was a storm and the waves were crashing, the wind was blowing, and you're just constantly getting beat down. You're constantly getting beaten. You're constantly getting wet. And
Preach.
You're just asking the Lord, Lord, I need to get dry. Lord, I need to get out of this. And God's just standing on the shore with a big tent saying, if you just come to me, if you just get out of the wind, if you,
yeah,
just get out of the waves and
Amen.
Come to me,
Amen.
I can put you under
That's
my
right.
shelter, and I can give you a life that you never knew you could have.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
Glory, preach, yeah, brother.
Proverbs 14:21 says, trouble chases sinners,
yep,
but blessings chase the
That's
righteous.
Right.
And I don't know about you.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you. Mm-hmm. But I know for me, I've had a bad past. You know, I haven't always been saved. I'm standing up here and you're thinking, man, this guy, he's something. He's got it all together. He's preaching about holiness. He's preaching about this. I want you to know today, make no mistake about it, I haven't always been saved.
Mm-hmm.
My brother, who's 5 years older than me, I would take his ID when I was 15 and 16 years old, and I'd go to the clubs in Greenville, North Carolina. I'd party the night away. I was an alcoholic. It began just, you know, one night I'd drink, two nights I'd drink. Next thing you know, it was 4 or 5 nights a week. I could put down a whiskey a night. A fifth of whiskey a night. It was no issue. See, I had to make that decision to turn from my wicked ways,
yeah,
and be changed by my Lord and Savior Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
I don't know about you, but I was in that situation. And maybe you've been in that situation, or you know somebody who's been in that situation, or maybe you're in that situation right now, where you may be saying to yourself, or maybe you've heard somebody else say, man, I just can't catch a break. Just when it seems like I get one step forward, next thing you know, it's two steps back. I was trying to do this, and next thing you know, this happened. A sudden storm happened. Something come into my life, and I just can't seem to catch a break. I'm here to tell you today that the Bible says trouble chases sinners. But when you come over to the winning
That's
side
right.
of Jesus Christ,
Preach.
The Bible says
Preach.
The blessings will chase the righteous.
Yes.
Blessings will begin to chase you down.
Yes.
The Bible says in Matthew 6:33, seek first my kingdom, Jesus says, and my righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you.
Yes.
You won't even be trying to strive for it. Just by you living
yes.
pure and living
yes.
holy, blessings will begin to chase you down.
Lord.
If you're a test of that, can you shout amen?
Yes.
Lift your hands to heaven and just thank God that He's bringing you out, that He's going to do it today. Hallelujah.
Woo!
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Proverbs 4:18 says that the path of the righteous is like the sun breaking forth on a new day.
Amen.
Think about it. The sun, it starts off, you know, starting off slow
right.
and rises higher. And higher. The Bible says that the path of the righteous is like the sun breaking forth on a new day, shining brighter and brighter into the full day of light. God has a plan to take you higher and higher if you'll serve Him, if you'll love Him, if you'll dedicate your life starting today to say, today,
preach,
I am going to go forward in everything that God has for me. I'm going to live in the fullness of the purpose that God has for me. I'm going to be dead to the world.
Glory,
and I'm going to say yes to
Jesus.
Today is the day that God wants to make your life new.
Amen.
He wants to see you go higher and higher. Can I tell you today, the Bible says we go from faith to faith. We go from glory to glory. We go from victory to victory and strength to strength. Starting today, you're not going to see a life of ups and downs. Can I tell you that God never desired for you to have a life of ups and downs. Can I tell you today, God has never desired for you to have a life of mountains and valleys. David found himself in a valley. But can I tell you, David said, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. He prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies.
Amen.
He anoints my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely your goodness and your mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Preach,
and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Yeah. Hallelujah. David said, even though I walk through the valley. See, David walked through the valley. He didn't camp out in it. I'm here today to tell you that God wants to see you go from a life of ups and downs to a life of ups and ups. Only mountains and valleys.
I love it.
Hallelujah. I want to ask you to make a decision today.
Glory. You have the anointing. Hallelujah.
The Bible says in 2 Timothy 2:20 that in a wealthy home, some utensils, some vessels, some forks, some knives, some spoons, some plates. In a wealthy home, some utensils are made for special use, for special occasions. But some are made for ordinary use. Everyday, ordinary use. The Bible says that in a wealthy home, some utensils are made of gold and silver, and some are made of wood and clay. The Bible says that if you keep yourself pure, the Bible says that you'll be a vessel made unto honor, fit for the master's use, for every good work.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you, but I want to be fit for the master's use, for every good work. Hallelujah. Lord, as you come and you play a little something on the keyboard.
Glory.
Hallelujah. You know, I believe that one of the reasons why that the body of Christ as a whole is not seeing the true manifestation of the miracles and the signs and the wonders that Jesus said we could have in the Bible is because the church, a lot of the church is lukewarm. Jesus said, and I don't mean that to condemn anybody, I'm just being real. The Bible says in Revelation 3, that Jesus said, I would rather you be hot or cold.
Yes.
But because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. One version says, I want to vomit you out of my mouth. Mm-hmm. It's like drinking coffee. I don't know about you, but I love my coffee. I love coffee, but I like it hot or I like it cold. I love iced coffee, and I love hot coffee. But I don't know about you, but I don't like lukewarm coffee. I just want to spit it out of my mouth. Jesus says, that's what he wants to do to a lukewarm Christian.
Thank you, Father.
I want you to know today that Jesus wants to set you ablaze.
Thank you, Father.
Jesus wants to set you on fire. You say, what do you mean by fire? I don't mean by an eternal separation from God and hellfire.
Thank
I'm talking
you,
about what John the Baptist said. In Luke 3:16, he says, I baptize you with water, but there's one coming after me whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. I'm talking about a fire that will burn out all the dross. It'll burn out all the chaff.
Preach.
It'll burn out all the addiction. It'll burn out all the bondage. It'll burn out all the depression. It'll burn out all the oppression. It'll burn out all the anxiety. It'll burn everything that God does not desire for you to have in your life. God wants to give you that fire. He wants to fill you new and afresh today. I want you to know today that the Lord says that His mercies are new and afresh every morning. That His joy comes in the morning. That He wants to offer you His joy today. The Bible says true religion is not meat or drink, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. God doesn't want you to strive like the rest of this world. I hear so many young people today, they say, man, the struggle is real. I want you to know today, Jesus wants you to know and say and proclaim from this day forward that the struggle is now over. I want you to say,
hallelujah, hallelujah.
I want you to say this with me by faith. I want you to say, I'm not like everybody else. And I don't have to be like everybody else. God has a path forward for you today. Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans not to harm you, but plans to prosper you.
Preach.
Plans to give you a hope and a future. That word future means expected end. God has an expected end in mind for every individual in this room today. But he calls you to live a new life. He calls you to come into his kingdom. He calls you to be separate from the world. Can I tell you that that word holy means to be separated? It means to be set apart. It means to be reserved for God's use. God wants you to come out from the world and be set apart.
Yes. Glory, glory.
Thank you, Lord. Yes. Hallelujah. The Bible says in Proverbs 5:22 that an evil man's sins are ropes that catch and hold him, and he's not even free to do what he wants. See, a lot of people think, well, man, if I give my life to Jesus, man, if I try this God thing, I feel like I'm stuck. I feel like I'll be in some type of, I'll be like a servant. I won't be able to be free. But can I tell you, the devil has lied to you by making that statement to you? Because what you don't understand is that the Bible says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, there is freedom. When you come to the living side of Jesus Christ, God offers you freedom. It's the devil that will keep you bound up and enslaved.
Come on.
But God wants to offer you a brand new life today.
That's right.
Judges 15:14. Samson was captured by the Philistines, and they bound him up in ropes, and they took him. But the Bible says that when the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon Samson, the Bible says that the ropes were burnt off of him as if they were burnt by fire, and they fell off of his wrist.
Amen.
Samson didn't snap them off of his wrist. It was the fire that burnt the ropes right off of his wrist when the anointing came upon him. I'm here today to tell you that Isaiah 10:27 says that the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. I don't know what kind of yoke you may have today, no matter how big or how small, but I want you to know today that the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the power of the blood of Jesus Christ can destroy that yoke of bondage today, and you can be a brand new man, a brand new woman starting right now. Hallelujah.
Amen.
With every head bowed, every eye closed, I want to ask you something. I'm going to ask you to make a decision today. Maybe you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here today and you say, if I were to die tonight, if I were to go home and lay my head on the pillow, and if I were to breathe out my last breath tonight, Travis, I don't think I'd be saved. I don't think I'd go to heaven. If you want to know that you know that you know, that you're sure of your eternal salvation, that if your life were to be required of you today, that you would wake up in the arms of Jesus. If that's you today, in a few minutes, I want to give you a call to come forward, and I want to pray for you. Maybe you're here today, and there's something hidden that nobody knows about. Pride, unforgiveness, lust, bitterness, shame, guilt, condemnation. Maybe the devil has tried to trap you. Maybe he's tried to lie to you and tell you that you can never be free, that you can never live a life free, but I'm here to tell you today, but there's a song, and just like that old song said, there is a fountain filled with blood that was drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and
sinners
who plunge beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. I want you to know today that God is a God of a second chance and a new beginning.
Glory.
There's a second chance for you today. I don't care how bad it is. I don't care what you've done. There's nothing that the blood of Jesus can't forgive you of.
Glory.
Maybe you're here today and there's something happening. Maybe it's something outward that everybody knows about. Maybe it's a sin. Maybe it's a past thing that's happened. And people use it against you. People try to shame you. They try to put guilt on you. But I'm here today to tell you that from this day forward, you can become a new person. That if somebody were ever trying to bring that up, you can say, that was the old me. But that ain't me now. I'm new. I've become a new man. I've become a new woman. Maybe you're here today and you say, Travis, I was serving God. But a storm may have come. A storm came and it rocked your world and it threw you off. Maybe it was a sudden illness, a loss of a job, a sudden divorce, a loss of a loved one, a loss of a child, a bankruptcy. Something came and just rocked your world, and it threw you off, and it took that fire away. And if you're here today, you say, Travis, I want to know that I know that I'm saved. I want to get it right. Maybe you're here today and you say, Travis, look, man, there's no doubt in my mind that I love God. There's no doubt in my mind that I love Jesus. But I just simply want to know that I know that I know that I am saved. And I want to walk out of these doors forever changed and transformed. If that's you today, you fit into any of those categories. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I just want you to slip your hand up and I want to pray for you. If that's you, you fit into any of those categories. Hallelujah. I see that hand. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Glory.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory.
Thank you,
Lord. Glory.
Now I want to ask you to do one more thing. Jesus said that if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father in heaven. But he says, if you confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father in heaven. If you raised your hand and you said, Travis, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ, I want you to come up out of your seat real quickly. And I want to just pray for you right now. You don't have to do anything crazy or stupid. I'm not going to make you do anything crazy. I just simply want to pray with you and for you. If that was you, if you raised your hand, I want you to come out of your seat. And I want you to come forward and I want to pray quickly with you.
Glory, glory, glory.
Yes, in the name of the healing power of God. Lauren Turner.
I knew from the time God planted it in my head, this was the day.
Yes.
I've had him preaching for me before. This is not his first time preaching for me, and it's not his last. There's an anointing from his wife to him and to his two children that will rock North Carolina, United States, and all over the world. Evangelist Travis Turner and his wonderful wife, Sister Lori Turner. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Three salvations. I give you the glory, God.
Yes, Jesus.
With you allow me, I know you. We are moving and going along, and even if you need to stand to stretch your legs, it's something that I do, and I made a commitment. Oh, I even said if Jenny Swaggart comes here to preach, the two people that sing specials for us would sing. Even if Jenny Swaggart comes up here. Because I've got just such the anointing of not more anointing. Yes, I'm that confident in God.
Amen.
Because he's done a great work and you have just or not on board of that anointing too.
Amen.
Evangelist Travis Turner.
Yes.
And your wife, Lori.
Amen. Amen.
We,
woo! Praise God. Which
one is singing first? Okay, and then you're going to come up?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Hopefully this speaker system won't go cracking. We're live. We're live in Aback, Nigeria. We're live in Mondesi, Kenya. We're live in Portmore, Jamaica. We're live in Pakistan and India. Yes, we are live. And we're live in heaven.
Yes.
Glory.
Glory to God.
I just wanted everybody to know that. We're live.
Amen.
Yes.
While they're getting ready, come here, evangelist.
Yes, hallelujah.
While they're getting ready, tell them about your ministry.
Okay. Well, my wife and I, we just started our evangelistic ministry. It's called Faith Ignited Ministries. We're based out of Ahoskie, North Carolina. But God is on the move. This is a year to run.
Yes.
When I mean run,
yes.
I mean do the will of the Father.
Right.
And, Jesus is coming soon.
Amen.
So, we're getting busy, and I'm just thankful for open doors and opportunities. I'm thankful for Pastor David that he invited me to come and preach, and me and Lauren will be in another city next week. And
the
best is yet to come. But if you want to find anything out about us, we have a website. It's faithignited.net. And you can find the schedule, and you can find all of our events that we're planning there. We have a lot of things in store, and we're just excited. Amen?
Amen.
Get, brother, before you leave, tell them that website again and go a little slower. I won't coach to nobody.
Yes.
I respect you highly.
I appreciate it. Faithignited.net.
Yes.
And it has our schedule. It has our About Me page. You can actually... you can donate, sow a seed if you would like to on the website securely. Some people give by snail mail. You can do that at P.O. Box 563, Ahoskie, North Carolina. Many ways to give. You can give by cash out. It's going to be $FIGIVE, all capital letters. So many ways to sow to the ministry. We're actually planning something that we did last year, and it's called Hope Festival. Some people know it better as Hope Fest. And last year, we did an outside evangelistic crusade, and we gave away, thank the Lord. We were believing for many things to come in, and the Lord just blessed us financially. We were able to give away flat-screen TVs. We were able to give away iPads, AirPods. We were able to give away grocery boxes to the community. Everything was free.
Yes.
And we had two Christian comedians there, and they hosted the event, and we had a different speaker every night. And it was powerful. People got saved. People got baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, and it was just good. It was an awesome time, and we're planning to do another Hook Fest this year as well. It's going to be at the end of the summer, the end of August. You can check those dates. It's going to be August 27th, 28th, and 29th. And the location is to be announced. We're getting ready to announce that location. But if you want to be a part, if you want to volunteer in any way, I mean, we would love to have you help out. And it would be a blessing to us just to see the harvest come in. You know, the Bible says that Jesus said that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. So praise the Lord that he would send out harvesters. So that's what we're doing. And if you'd like to be a part of that, you can as well to help us reach lost souls. Yeah.
Thank you, bro.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, buddy.
Wow.
Sister Anita Dalloway.
What a service today.
Yes, amen.
It's been a long time since I felt the presence on me like this today. Travis and your wife, y'all really working for God, because it had just tore me up today, the presence of the Lord. This song is perfect for today because it's called No Ordinary Worship. And I just thank God for using me. And when you called me a while ago, Pastor, my heart started flying. I said, Lord, calm me down, because I'm very hyper anyway. I said, calm me down, Lord. And he's so good. I just want him to use me, so he's doing it. Yes. So I give you praise, God. Anoint my voice, Lord. And I love all of you. Amen. Let's just live for the Lord and thrive to live for the Lord, because the devil's busy in this world. Amen. I got scared yesterday. Me and my boyfriend was cutting grass. I heard about 10 gunshots, and I was right there at it. And over across the street, across from Assemblies of God, Neil and I was over there cutting the grass at the campground from Windsor. Right across the street, a man just got shot in the head. And you may hear something on the news about it, but it was just, it's scary, y'all. The devil is busy. But I just thank God that all of us know the Lord. And I pray many more come. And I'm so proud of the ones that accept the Lord today.
Yes.
It's going to get better.
Yes.
The life is going to get at peace. You're going to be able to handle things better in your life.
Amen.
So I want to sing this song, No Ordinary Worship.
This ain't no ordinary worship. Yeah. This ain't no ordinary song. The God has been greater than the ordinary.
Glory.
Pastor Ronnie, introduce your wife as she's going to sing our final song today.
Amen.
Introduce your wife. And while he is introducing her, let's take up our offerings, our tithes and offerings. We do have bills to pay.
Yes.
We do have bills to pay.
I've got to say this, Pastor.
Go ahead.
This young lady was sipping on a sippy cup, singing praise in the back seat of a car seat, and it paid off, says the Lord. Amen. But anyway, as my wife comes today, I just want to thank God for what he's doing in Growing Together Ministry and the people that are part of Growing Together Ministry. Thank you for the word today, Brother Turner, and I pray that God will continue to use you and your wife and your family in a great and mighty way. But anyway, Sister Wanda to come, my wife, and let the Lord just bless you with what God has laid on our heart. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He was talking about Lauren sitting in the back seat of her mom and daddy's car. She don't know who we are, but I know when I saw you come in, I couldn't believe it, but she was a little bitty thing, and just every praise and worship song that would come on, it just amazed me how little she was, 2 and 3 years old, and she would know every word to every song that would come on. And I just thank God, because he was grooming her and preparing her then for the life that she's living now.
Amen.
And I just thank God for it. I thank God for it, because even then I could see the Holy Spirit moving in a child. So don't ever think the child is not receiving and getting what's happening in church, because they're getting it.
Amen.
Praise God. Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Sing it, sister.
You see,
Yes.
When he comes in a cloud of glory, you'll see that it was more than just a story. It wasn't just a fairy tale. There is a heaven, there is a hell. One day.
Pastor Larry, come up here. It's, what's tomorrow, buddy?
Memorial Day.
Tell us something about it.
Over 1 million people, almost 1.5 million soldiers have lost their lives in all the wars.
Amen.
That's the Civil War, the Indian Wars, all over the world, Americans. I was honored to have served 25 years.
Praise God.
Brother Larry Rubble, I will call his name out, he served in Vietnam. I was in during the Vietnam War, but I wasn't where he was. He got shot at, I didn't. And he made it home safely.
Glory.
Jesus. Praise God.
And I try to wear my uniform every year in honor of all the Americans that lost their lives. That's not counting the civilians that lost their lives. That's just the soldiers. And so tomorrow is not just for a picnic.
Come on, come on.
Come on.
Not just for a fish fry.
Come on.
That's right.
It's not just to have a day off from work.
Yes, amen.
We need to stop and think.
Yes.
That the freedom we have left is because those people gave their lives.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
And I'm so thankful. I had the opportunity to visit.
Jesus.
I won't mention this, but the places I was stationed in America was numerous, but I had the opportunity to be in Guam, which was USA territory, Okinawa, Japan, the Philippines, and South Korea. I'll never forget, I was standing in the Philippines. I think what year it was, around 1982 or 3. And saw the dirtiness of the country, the poverty the people were living in. We were not allowed Americans to drink any water off the premises unless it was bottled water because the wells are so shallow over there. And all I could do was sit there and say, thank God for America.
Jesus.
America has its problems and its issues, the moral standards, but you don't know how blessed you are, you really, until you can visit a foreign country and see their living conditions. You better be thankful that you are an American.
Yes,
for your service to all of you that are here. And you've served in the military. Please stand. You've served in the military or stand or you have served. Praise God. Thank you. The military. Thank you. Thank you. You have discipline like no other people ever will dream of having.
That's right.
You have discipline.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Honey, make sure, and I know I'm still alive, we're getting ready to close.
make sure that those three salvations are recorded on this.
Thank you, Jesus.
Carrying it to them. I love to work her. I haven't lost anyone. Everyone has stayed. It's been a powerful, powerful, powerful move of God. We have a great, great crowd here today, and I'm still missing people. Yes I am. I'm missing people.
Amen.
I had them texting me this morning where they were going to be, and then they were telling me about tomorrow, which I'm not going live with that. And I have my reasons for not doing that live.
Thanks, God.
But we love you all. We're not a joke.
Jesus.
We're not fly by night. But yes, we are led by God. We're not led by people.
Amen.
We're not controlled by a man or a woman. We're led by God.
Amen.
We're not led by a dollar bill. We're led by God. And I stress this, we're led by God. When folks' feelings get hurt, it's because they made that happen.
Amen.
God doesn't make your feelings get hurt because you're too much in the flesh and you're not enough in the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And you need to be man and woman enough to admit you're more in your flesh than you are in the Holy Spirit when you're saying somebody hurt my feelings.
Come on now.
This is, we must have vision. We must reach the world. We must reach the world. Your tunnel vision's not even getting you out of your house on a regular basis. And then when you do go to work, you're going back home because you have no vision to do nothing else. But vision is moving forward. And growing together ministry is moving forward.
Yes, we are.
Amen.
Yes,
but not only Burke T. County, but Martin County.
All of them.
Martin County. Hertford County. All over Northampton County.
Yes.
Pitt County. Yes, do I have people that come here from Pitt County? Yes, we do.
Yes.
They're not here today. But we do. But we have vision. The unsaved to reach, and something that's very important, Evangelist Travis term, that is a great need as we wrap up this Sunday. And honey, I'm going to eat and I'm going to lay down. I took a lot, and the Spirit is going to, you know, bad words. I'll get it off of me. I took a lot this morning. I'm going to have to lay down after we eat. This is about seeing you that say that you're saved, you're a Christian, move to the next level in God and never, never be the same again. That means you're more happier than you've ever been. That means because when you walk in your house this afternoon, you hear a cuss word, you hear something ugly, or the phone rings, the gossip line rings to try to get you involved in their mess.
Amen.
You need to rebuke them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This is about moving in the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
I'm not where I need to be, and you're not either.
Come on.
But I am striving for this flesh to die every moment of every minute, of every hour, of every day, that my flesh dies more. Just because I've had the call of God on my life for 39 years, don't mean jack if I'm not growing in God.
He's right. Amen.
And it don't mean jack how long you've been saved, or how old you are, or how young you are.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. And all you that are here know what's happening tomorrow. Cut that off. Someone cut that off. Thank you for joining us. We love you.